Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week, we're in Washington within the Quinault Indian Nation on the Olympic Peninsula, fishing the Queets River for winter steelhead. If you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. The 53-mile-long Queets River flows from Humes Glacier on Mount Olympus, providing murky but cool year-round water, ideal for growing steelhead. We're with guide Rich Underwood, along with Steve Lynch and Jason Hambly from Procure.
Hey, good morning, everybody. We're on the Queets River. Today's plan is just to try to see if we can get them on soft beads and worms, side drifting, bobber dogging. Conditions are good, weather looks great, should be a couple of fish laying around here, so looking forward to it, having a good day.
So we're going to try three different scents. Jason's using shrimp, I'm using Ann's buddy tuna, and we've got the shrimp krill in the back there. Yes, sir.
What I like about these burr beads already now is you can really kind of pack that scent. So that works really well. You just kind of smear it around there. Them round ones, they don't kind of stick, but these ones you can kind of pack around them little sharp points there. So I kind of like that idea. We're starting up here on the Queet side. Down below is going to be the Clearwater. The confluence of the Clearwater empties into the Queets. So this morning we're going to start off on the Queets and on the Queets side, and then a little later on this morning we're going to try the Clearwater side where they meet, they come together. So yeah, that's what I meant about fishing the Queets this morning. We're going to try both the Queets and the Clearwater. So we'll see what happens. I'm going to try a drift setup right in that one spot right there. You know that one spot, Steve? Yeah, that spot right there. Oh, you mean that one? That one right there in that little soft pocket water right there. Let it drag right on out. You know, the Quinault is, you know, we have a different run here than the Queets, but the Queets River seems to produce a lot of nice steelhead too, but not as large as the ones on the Quinault. But they're really nice fish here. They're only about 8 miles from out of the salt water up in heading back up into the hatchery, but these ones here are predominantly the wild fish, more so than the hatchery fish right now, because we're in March, mid-March. So looking forward to catching average steelhead on the Queets is probably 14-15 pounds as well, but on a Quinault, you can probably catch a 18 pounder. They can average about 16, 17 pounds, so that's a difference. Yeah, little guy was just peckering away. There you go, Jason. Nice. All right, there he is, right behind that rock.
You got the net in that. You got the first hook of the net, Rich. I can't believe I can't net that thing now. Oh, I know it.
There you
go. Man, sometimes you do everything right, you lose them. Next time you do everything wrong, and still get them.
Oh, yeah, that's a little wild. I'm going to
set
him back in there, Jason. And I'll do a shore over there.
That was fun. Well, that's one problem with two-hook rigs is the first hook was up higher, so it got hung up in the net. when Rich went to get it, so he couldn't get the net under the fish. So luckily it was pretty well worn out by that time, so he was able to dink around with it for a few minutes and finally got it in. It's a wild fish, we're gonna release it, so we got her sitting in there waiting to go back in.
That one's looked like about an 8-9 pounder. So yeah, we'll see as the day progresses. You know, we're still early in the morning. Maybe that could be the run. Hopefully find a bigger fish.
That's pretty fish.
Welcome back to the Queets River. I'm Justin Wolf. It's a cool March morning and we're steelhead fishing with Rich Underwood. We're using soft beads not only because they are effective, but also because they tend to be less harmful to released fish.
We caught that one on a soft bead, 20 mil soft bead. You know, the nice thing about them soft beads is, you know, the hook they don't swallow it like they would with bait. They'll swallow that all the way down to the gill plates, and then, you know, you get them to bleed. And, you know, when we're trying to be careful and preserve these fish, well, the best thing to do is use soft beads. So that's what we did. We're using soft beads.
Last couple days, this has kind of been what I've been running. It's been working real well. It's a shrimp super gel. I just put a little tiny bit on the bead. You don't need a ton. You just wipe that around on there. You're good to go.
That's one for shrimp. We'll catch up, don't you worry. Woo, daddy. They can warm up about 8-10 degrees. Oh, that'd be nice. That'd be perfect. Come on, sunshine. Good man.
Oh, he just came off. Oh no, he's running.
Woo!
Good
going.
That's a nice bigger fish, isn't it?
That's a happy fish.
Yeah, look at that thing. I'll let him play around there for a while until you guys feel like giving me a hand. Well, we're still on our first pass, and these fish are, that one was super aggressive. I mean, it was no doubt about it. I'm not bobber dogging. I'm just drift fishing. Anyway, that thing was, it just super aggressive. Grab that bead. Well, not the bead, the burr beads is what I'm using. And it hit the clown. It hit the clown, Steve. So, okay, here he comes. There you go, Steve. Oh, it's about the same size as that other one.
Yeah.
And we'll do the same thing with that one, right, Steve? We'll,
yes, sir.
We'll go ahead and unbutton that one and let her go. Let her go through the thing. About an average, it looks very similar to the first one we caught.
Oh yeah,
that thing was strong. It took right off, no problem. Again, you know, I can't emphasize enough what these beads do, even the burr beads. Any type of beads, you know, you if you don't want to harm fish and you want to see an arm, this is the way to go. You know, you're not going to hurt them. They're caught on the outside of the mouth and unharmed. Like you see, that one was released and super strong, took right off. Great. Well, we'll go up and make that little pass again, see what happens. The burr bead's got a little bit more surface there for the current to catch it. So it actually wobbles a little bit more. And you know, like I stated earlier, you know, when I do the loop knot, and if you break your hook, you can always take it off. But the other thing that is beneficial is that knot. That knot also helps that T-stop from sliding down to the hook. So anyway, that's one advantage we have over the fixed beads. There, oh, a little bit of shrimp and krill. That hit shrimp and krill that time. You know, I think it might be just the I'll tell you, they're just super aggressive. They're hungry. Man, they hit. They'll hit all this stuff. The scent, especially the shrimp scent. That's two on shrimp, right? Yeah, Jason and Steve are bobber dogging, and I'm side drifting. You know, bobber dogging is more sight than feel. Side drifting like this is more feel. I mean, you're essentially doing the same thing without the bobber. I like to feel the bite. So we'll try it again. Oh yeah. So the weight that I'm using, I'm just using a little piece of pencil lead, and I believe you get a little bit more feel than them coated ones. But again, it's kind of the old school coming out at me, I guess. The only thing I ain't using is the surgical tubing, but in fairness, I'm still old school way. So we'll keep it that way.
This is a basic bobber dog setup. It's what I'm running is a piece of 15-pound P-line CFX. Actually, this is CXX on the bumper here. And I run it up to a splice in my main line. And I run the bobber stopper right below the splice, which is about 8 feet up. And if it gets shallower, I can move my bobber stopper down. And I run a medium-sized bobber dog and float, and a bead between the bobber stopper and the bobber. And then I run a little P-line snapping swivel with a P-line weight on here. And then off of that other side here, I'm running a double bead setup, and I usually run it about 2 feet between the big bead and the small bead, and 2 feet from the big bead to the bobber, so it ends up having about 4 feet a leader. And that seems to work out okay. Depends who you talk to. Some people like them longer, some people like them shorter, but that's where I'm at.
We're on the Queets River with Quinault Nation guide Rich Underwood, along with Steve Lynch and Jason Hambly. We have a couple fish to the boat, and there's no reason to think that there won't be more. These fish are mostly a product of an effective hatchery system that works to maintain the strong genetics of the native fish.
We're gonna go back up and make another pass through that same spot, because we hooked, geez, two or three in that freaking first run, so we're gonna do it again.
Long runs, too many boats, this is crazy. We were out all day yesterday on the Quinault, never saw another boat. So far today on the Queets, haven't seen a boat. This is, in my neighborhood, would either be closed fishing or there'd be no fish. Or 10,000 boats.
Oh, that might be a big one.
There is.
Wow. Oh, that is a big one.
Yeah, that one there is a spawner.
Trailer.
Okay, I'm gonna back down again. There you go. There you go. Now I've got it.
That's another problem with the two-hook rig is the top hook, it hit it, and then the back hook got in the back, so I was trying to drag it in backwards. It was a pain in the butt.
It's double trouble there.
There.
Did I get it?
Yeah, I did. Thank you. Come on.
I think it's in the back. It'll just wrap.
Yeah, I got the big bead on here for kind of for buoyancy, but it helps get everything up where it needs to be. But that fish hit the little one, which is usually the case, but not always. That was the bead.
Come on, sunshine.
Confluence be right around the corner. Queets and the Clearwater come together. We call that the confluence. And when the Queets is murky, which generally is worse than this, you get in the confluence now and you fish the Clearwater. Then you get a little bit below it, maybe a half a mile down there. We call it the mixing bowl. And what it does is the Clearwater and the Queets come together and it mixes. So everything down below that now is a little bit more clearer than it is up top here. So that's one of the benefits we have when we fish the confluence. Uh-oh. That's a big one. You got the world by the tail there, Steve. You got the world by the tail, buddy.
I took a gamble and I lost.
A lot of good looking water. This all used to be fast. So fast you can hardly fish it. You can only fish the inside seam behind me. But now, from the looks of it, it's got a little gravel bar that formed out there in the center, and we got a little soft spot. Fish, they travel in them fast, that fast water, and they get a little relief when they hit this stretch up here and get into some softer water. And that's the kind of stuff we like to target. Target that softer water. We're doing okay so far, gentlemen. So I think what we're gonna do, as we get into the confluence, here's the confluence now. This is what I was talking about. That's the clear water on the other side, this little gravel bar. And this is the Queets. We're on the Queets side. So they're gonna come together right down here. And what I wanna do this first pass, guys, is I wanna try the Queets side first, okay? And so we're just gonna go through and try the Queets, and then we'll make another pass. Okay. And then I'll hit the clear water side, and we'll see where these fish are, where they're congregating. But I mean, you can try it now, Steve. Look at that little seam right there. Go ahead and get it in that seam. That's a little bit of the clear water, the head of it. There you go. Notice why they call it clear water. Clear water in the Queets. Queets is murky and a clear water is clear.
Got one.
Go in the net.
Got it. Nicely done.
We're getting there, brought to you by Corning Ford, the largest Super Duty dealer in the western U.S.
Hey everybody, hope you're enjoying today's episode from the Queets River, which is in the Quinault Indian Nation on the Olympic Peninsula in the state of Washington. I'm going to take a minute to show you how you can get there. All right, we're going to start here in Woodland, Washington at the Angler West Shop, and from here it is 2 hours and 50 minutes and 154 miles. So I'm going to show you on the big screen here. From the shop here in Woodland, Washington, you're just going to jump on I-5 north. When you get past Centralia, you're going to hook a left onto Highway 12, which will eventually take you to Highway 101 and straight to Amanda Park. Very simple. Now, Amanda Park is typically the place where your guide is going to want to meet you. The Quinault River Inn is typically where you're going to stay. So it's a great situation to be in. Good deep from there, you got the Queets or the Quinault and some of the best steelhead fishing and salmon fishing in the world. So let's get back to the Queets River and see if we can't hook up with some more steelhead.
But first, it's time for fresh elk burgers.
We eat all that junk food, and you know, it's kind of nice to have something good for you.
We've released most of our fish today, but retention is allowed typically for smaller hatchery fish. But regardless of the fish, presentation is everything.
That's a keeper.
Nice little fish.
Sometimes there's variations in the boat speed, the current speed, the angle of the boat, everything. And the biggest thing is don't just pull your bobber around all over the place. The biggest thing is to always let line out and offset that. Just like any bobber fishing, it's got to be floating perfectly natural.
Yeah, you know, the price of gear nowadays going up, and you know, we used to just use one stop. That's all you used was one stop. But you know, we got tired of going, we'd break off, said, that's okay. But now we're using I use a double setup here, a double stopper setup. See, it's just above your three-way swivel, so in case you do snag up, you break off, you lose all this stuff, or you lose part of it, but you keep your float.
Big, but fish.
Mm-hmm.
Dolly.
Dolly? Yeah. You know, those dollies, I'll tell you, they're a predator fish, and they eat a lot of the smolts, out-migrating smolts. So, you know, here we get rid of them. We take them out of the system. You know, so that way, our out-migrating smolts have an opportunity. Where, about where that thing was laying, just right on the drop end of the riffle, just as it deepens up,
that's where they like to hang out, because without migrating smolts, when they're coming down those shallow riffles like that, he just sits there and waits for them, and they ambush them. So there's a lot of, there's probably three or four more in there, Jason.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was out more sore in the middle. Yeah, this time, geez, we were going right over the top of them this morning.
Oh no, that's not the same one.
that's a buck there.
Big old buck.
We've been fishing the bank most of the day and figured I'd try something different and chuck out in the middle in the fast water, and there was a big buck laying there. Worked out good.
No, it's a good, it's good quality fish, and that's kind of the ones we want to mate up there. And you know, I don't know how many first time up here, so you know, obviously there's some real nice fish up here, but that's the first one we've seen this today that size. Look at that thing. That away. Yeah, that's a quality fish. You know, good genes in that thing. We want them to go up and spawn. And it's that late in the year, mid-March. They're gonna run through till about the end of April. We'll probably see a lot more of those, but you know what? We've got plenty of them big fish. You know, we've done our share, so it's nice to catch them. Even better to let them go. Good job, man.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching today's episode. And be sure to stop by the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. I'm sure we can help you catch more fish. And remember, without the sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.